Hello everyone, welcome back to Chemistry CC for you. Today we are doing the part 2 of Super Preparation series, and today we are focusing on CUSET MSc entrance examination. We have taken questions from previous years, from 2014 to 2019, that is the past 5 years questions, and also probable questions that might be asked. So before I begin this question discussion, I would like to tell you that all the questions that we are going to discuss in the super preparation series will be different for CUSAT, CUSET, even BHU, everything it would be different, so that you will get a touch of all the different portions asked in various MSc chemistry entrance examination, and also cover the syllabus as much as you can. So I would suggest that students, those who are preparing for CUSET, you please watch the CUSAT video as well, because there may be questions that will be important for both the exams. But since I have asked it in the previous video, I might not have included that in this one. So please watch both of this so that it will be helpful for you as a whole. Let's begin the first question. So the first question is, raffinose is made up of galactose, glucose, fructose, or mannose, glucose, galactose, this combination. So from the question itself, it is very clear that raffinose is a trisaccharide, and it would be made up of, trisaccharides would be made up of three monomers. So the answer here is galactose, glucose, and fructose. Option A is the right answer. And this is the structure of raffinose. It is having the five-membered sugar system is the fructose. The other two are galactose and glucose. And for your reference, here are the important trisaccharides and their monomeric units. Out of this, I would suggest you to memorize at least ketose, raffinose, and maltotriose, because these are very important and it is easy to remember also. Maltotriose is made up of three units of glucose, while raffinose is made up of galactose, glucose, and fructose. And for ketose, it is glucose, fructose, and fructose. So these are the monomers of various important trisaccharides. Write this down so that you can revise it later on. So since one question is about the trisaccharides, we could expect a question from the disaccharide portion as well. So what makes up sucrose? So sucrose is made up of glucose and fructose. This is a very common fact that you know, and the thing you should remember is the structure of sucrose, which is made up of the glucose and fructose. Now the next thing that you can memorize would be the units of other important disaccharides, namely lactose, maltose, trehalose, etc. So sucrose is made up of glucose and fructose. Lactose is made up of galactose and glucose, and maltose is made up of two units of glucose. So these three would be the most important ones, with lactose also known as milk sugar and maltose also known as malt sugar. So this question was, sucrose question was asked previously in the exam. So you can expect the question on either lactose or maltose in the coming years, because there is a pattern in which this CUSET exam follows. They will be having similar patterns of question. They'll just change what they ask, but the portion they ask and the type of questions almost remains the same every year. Now we will go to the third question. Third question is, Van Hoff factor for a dilute solution of potassium ferrocyanide is. So we have not previously discussed the equations for the Van Hoff factor. Let's see all those today. So we have two different processes, which is dissociation and association. For the phenomena of dissociation, the Van Hoff factor represented by I can be expressed as 1 plus N minus 1 into alpha. And N is number of ions after dissociation. So after dissociation, we will be getting so many ions, and you need to find the sum of those ions. That would be N, and alpha would be the percentage dissociation. So if 100% dissociation occurs, it will be 100 by 100, and alpha will be equal to 1. That is what alpha is. Now first of all, when you have a question for potassium, for any compound regarding the Van Hoff factor, first you need to write the equation. So here we have potassium ferrocyanide, and we know that once it dissociates, it would be forming 4K plus plus 1 FeCN6 4 minus. So the total number of ions are 5, 4K plus and 1 FeCN6 4 minus. Since no information is given about the dissociation, only it is said that it is a dilute solution. So we assume that 100% dissociation is occurring in this case. And for 100% dissociation, we know that alpha will be equal to 1. That is 100 by 100, which is equal to 1. So first write the equation and find the number of ions formed after dissociation, which is 5 here. So n is equal to 5, alpha is equal to 1. Now we can directly substitute these values in this equation as 1 plus 5 minus 1, which is equal to 1 plus 4, which is 5. So option A is the right answer. Now, since we have discussed about dissociation, it is obviously important to discuss about what happens in association. So in association, if we consider n as the number of ions after association and alpha is the percentage association, we can write it as I equal to 1 minus alpha into 1 minus 1 by n. So this is the thing. I equal to 1 minus alpha into 1 minus 1 by n is a single term. So this is the Van Hoff factor for the process of association. Now again, this is a small note on what Van Hoff factor, why is it important, what it is. So what actually happens is, we know about colligative properties. So in colligative properties, sometimes the theoretical value and the actual value that we observe regarding a property will be different. And in such cases, we need to introduce a factor which would make this equal for the abnormal cases. For that, we introduce a factor known as Van Hoff factor. And Van Hoff factor is given as the ratio of observed colligative property to the theoretical value of the colligative properties. So that's it. Now, let's take a look at one more question of this part, this type. The Van Hoff factor is 3 for which of the following? So we have Na2SO4, and the percentage dissociation is different for all the four cases given. Let's take one by one. For Na2SO4, we can see that the total number of ions formed after dissociation is 3. So in our equation, I is equal to 1 plus 3, which is N, minus 1 into 0.5. Why? Because the percentage dissociation is given as 50%. So 1 plus 3 minus 1 into 0.5, which is equal to 2. Similarly, in the second case, Al2SO4 thrice. In this aluminium sulfate, there is no information about dissociation. So as we said in the first case, we assume that 100% dissociation occurs, and thereby we will take the value as 1, alpha, value of alpha as 1. And the number of ions formed after dissociation is 5. So I is equal to 1 plus 5 minus 1 into 1, which is I equal to 5. Again, this is also not the answer that we are looking for. Third one is CaCl2. Again, this is not important. This is so I is equal to 1 plus 3 minus 1 into 0.8, where 80% of dissociation occurs. The answer is 2.6. And further, in the last case, it is 3. So this is how you need to calculate. What you have to do, you have to write the equation, find the number of ions formed after dissociation, see what is the percentage dissociation, and continue with your equation. It's very simple. Remember these two equations and you can get the Van Hoff factor for any questions asked. Next question is from the portion of quantum mechanics. So the difference in energy levels of n equal to 2 and n equal to 1 of a particle in a box is 6 units in energy. So we need to find the difference in energy levels 3 and 2. 2 and 1 is given, we need to find between 3 and 2. So for a particle in a box, the energy is given by E equal to n square h square by 8 ma square, where n is the level, energy level. H is the Planck's constant, m is the mass of the particle, and a is the length of the box. So here we can write the energy of the first energy level as 1 square h square by 8 ma square, and of the second as 2 square h square by 8 ma square. Only n changes, all the other things remains the same. Now the difference in these levels is given as 6 units in energy. So we will be equating 6 and subtracting E2 and even. So we have 6 is equal to 2 square h square by 8 ma square minus 1 square h square by 8 ma square. And we will be taking the common factor h square 8 ma square outside, and we have 2 square, which is equal to 4, minus 1 square, which is equal to 1. So we have 6 is equal to 3 h square by 8 ma square. Therefore, we can write h square by 8 ma square is equal to 6 by 3 or 2. Once more, I'll explain it once more. So, energy of a particle in a box is n square h square by 8 ma square. First of all, you have to write it for the energy level 1 and 2. And what we have in the question is the difference between these energy levels. Then just subtract this and you will get a value for h square 8 ma square. That is for the constant, you can get a value. Now what we do, we will be just substituting it for E3 minus E2, just like what we have done in the case of E2 minus E1. What happens? H square by 8 ma square will be outside and 3 square minus 2 square will be there. 4 h square by 8 ma square is already given. We have already found it as 2 and 3 square is 9 and 2 square is 4. So 9 minus 4, which is equal to 5. Therefore, 2 into 5, 10 would be our answer. So this equation, if you have in mind, you can find the difference between any two energy levels. So you have to just substitute and understand what is the importance of the common term. Sometimes you will be having the value. If the mass and the length of the box is given, you can get the total value very, very easily. Here it's all about ratios, and you can find it from the given values. So yes, this is how you find. Next question, which of the following is a free radical? CS minus CO, NO, CN minus. The answer is NO. And this is environment for environmental chemistry, very important. NO free radical, this is very important in case of environmental chemistry. We'll be also taking a look at some other free radical names, which is superoxide, anion radical, hydrogen peroxide, hypochlorite, nitric oxide, which is already given, and also peroxynitrate radical. These are some other free radicals. Now the fifth question, which of the following have high hydration energy? We have magnesium, calcium, strontium, and barium chloride given. So we know that hydration enthalpy is inversely proportional to the size of the cation. So as the size of the cation increases, the hydration energy will be decreasing. Here, out of these four, the highest size of the cation will be for barium, and therefore it will be having the lowest hydration energy. And smallest cation is Mg2+, and therefore it will be having the hydration energy largest. So the largest hydration energy is for MgCl2, and the order in which this happens is MgCl2 greater than, calcium chloride greater than, strontium chloride greater than the barium chloride. And the important two important points that you have remember is atomic sizes increases down the group and hydration energy is inversely proportional to the size of the cation. And therefore, Mg2+ being the smallest cation have the highest hydration energy. Now the eighth question, which of the following orbital has highest energy? So in this, the important point that you have to, the answer is B5F. So greater the value of n plus l, n is the principal quantum number, more will be the energy of the orbital. So for s orbital, l equal to 0, the value of l equal to 0. For p it is 1, d it is 2, and f it is 3. Here we will be calculating the n plus l value for all the four of these orbitals and see which is having the highest value. So 5d it is 5 plus 2, 7. For 5f, it is 5 plus 3, 8. For 6s, it is 6 plus 0, 6. And 6p, 6 plus 1, 7. So the highest is for 5f, which has the sum 8 for the n plus l value. So greatest the n plus value, and therefore it is having the highest energy. This is to identify the product with molecular formula C15H16O2, which is formed when phenol acts with the acetone in the presence of concentrated H2SO4. So the answer is bisphenol. This is direct question. This you should memorize actually, because this is important for qualitative analysis of organic compounds as well. So phenol and acetone will, in the presence of concentrated sulfuric acid, will be forming bisphenol. And option D is our right answer, bisphenol. Next question. Since already it is asked about bisphenol, we can expect that phenol reacts with phthalic anhydride and concentrated H2SO4 and forms what? So it is the phenolphthalein. So last year the question was what species is found in acid and what species is found in base. So every time they try to ask a question from the part of phenolphthalein. So I expect that this year they will be asking this reaction. Phenol reacts with phthalic anhydride and concentrated acetylsulfur. So you have to remember all these structures, and also, like I have previously discussed, the how this exists in both acid and bases. You should remember that also. I'll be giving the link of previous videos of Kusset at the end of this video. Please watch that one as well. It will also help you. So yes, with phthalic anhydride and phenol will be forming phenolphthalein. Next question is, the root mean square velocity of a certain gas is 27 degrees Celsius is x meter per second. Its root mean square velocity at 927 degrees Celsius is. So root mean square velocity V RMS is given as square root of 3RT by M. So this whole quantity is under the square root. So this is the mass of the gas given. T is the temperature and R is the gas constant. So here except R, if it is of the same gas, the RMS value depends only on temperature. So if it is of same gas, if it is of different gas, both mass and temperature would be the varying factors. But here, since it's of the same gas, both the mass and the gas constant, this 3R, root 3R by M term is constant, and only root T is the varying factor. So 27 degrees Celsius is 300 Kelvin, 927 degrees Celsius is 1200 Kelvin. So we can write VRMS 1 divided by VRMS 2 is equal to square root of T1 by T2. So that is T1 here would be, this is T1. And this is T2. So we have 300, VRMS 2 is the one that we have to find. So VRMS 2, when this goes to this side, T2 will come up. So we have to write VRMS 2 will be equal to VRMS 1 into, this is under square root, okay? 1200 and 300 is under square root. So VRMS 1 into T2 by T1. So we have T1 as 300 and T2 as 1200, which is equal to square root of 4, which is 2, and 2 into x. Therefore, VRMS 2 will be 2x. Once again, for the same gas, the value of VRMS will be depending only upon the temperature. So if we are taking the ratio of two, the RMS velocity of two different gases, we can write V1 by V2 is equal to root of T1 by T2. This is the ratio. And this is exactly what we are following here. So what happens? V1 by V2. Here we have the value of V1 as X, and we need to find V2. So V2 will be equal to V1 into root of T2 by T1. Okay. And substituting these values, V1 is X, T2 is 1200, and T1 is 300 Kelvin. Overall, the answer is X into root 4, which is equal to X into 2, which is 2X. So option B is the correct answer of this question. Next question, the average velocity of a gas molecule is 500 meter per second. Calculate its RMS velocity at the same temperature. So here what we need is, we need the equation, two different equation. One is of the average velocity and second for the RMS velocity. So for RMS velocity, we already studied that it is root of 3RT by M. And for average velocity, it is root of 8RT by pi M. So VRMS by V average will be equal to root of 3RT by M divided by root of 8RT by pi M. This further can be summarized as VRMS by V average is equal to root 3 into pi root of pi by 8. This will simplify like this. And we know that V average is already given as 500. So VRMS by 500 is equal to root 3 into pi by 8. And root 3 into root pi by 8 is 1.085. Therefore, VRMS is equal to 500 into 1.085, which is 542 meter per second. Option C is the correct answer. So what we have to do, we have two equations here. For RMS, it is root of 3RT by M. For average velocity, it is root of 8RT by M. by finding their ratio, we have Vrms by V average is equal to root 3 into root pi by 8, which is approximately 1.85, and Vrms will be 500 into that quantity, and we will get the answer as 542 meter per second. Remember both these equations. Now the 13th question, this is a very, very simple question. We don't have much explanation, just the answer would be given. So which of the following represent a typical non-metal metal combination? A non-metal metal combination is B and L. Boron and aluminium represent option A here, represents the non-metal metal combination. Now, this is a very important question. So magnetic measurements indicate COOH twice, OH2, that is H2O, this is OH2, six times. 2 plus has 3 unpaired electrons. Therefore, the hybridization of the metals orbitals in this is. So we have 4 different hybridizations. Let's see. First of all, here CO is in the 2 plus oxidation state. So the number of d electrons is 7. So cobalt actually has, it is D7S2. 3D7 and 4S2. So CO2 plus these 2 electrons will be gone and only 3D7 will be present. And we will be filling it up in the 3D orbital as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6 and 7. So we have 7 electrons here. Now, next thing is we can either have, either it can be paired or it cannot, it won't be paired. According to the ligand, strength of the ligand, these electrons can be paired. So here water is the ligand and water is a weak ligand. So no pairing occurs and therefore the hybridization will be sp3d2. Okay, we have six ligands here. So sp3 and d2, it will be filled in here. The H2O ligand electrons will be filled across these six orbitals. In case if instead of H2O, it was some really powerful ligand like cyanide or something, then what happens is these will be getting paired up and we will be having D2 SP3. If it is a really powerful ligand, it will be D2 SP3. But here, since it is not powerful, it is a weak ligand, it is not getting paired and therefore the answer is sp3d2. Okay, that is the answer. And once again, you have to first of all you have to find the oxidation state of the metal, then you have to find the total number of electron in that particular oxidation state, fill in the orbitals, and then see whether the ligand is weak ligand or a strong ligand. Accordingly, you have to decide whether you should pair or not. And here it is already given that it has 3 unpaired electrons. So there are 3 unpaired electrons, and therefore it's a very straightforward question where we need six different orbitals now, which would be sp3 and d2. Very simple. Now we'll go to the 15th question. The conversion of the silver salt of carboxylic acid to alkyl halide is known as. So out of this, the very familiar reaction is aldol reaction. The answer here is Hunsdicker reaction. It is the reaction where silver salt of carboxylic acid reacts with halogens form. First, it will be forming an unstable intermediate, which will be then undergoing decarboxylation and form the final product, alkyl halide. So, the general representation of this equation will be like this. We have a silver salt of carboxylic acid, we'll be having a halogen and we'll get an alkyl halide. So, let's take a look at the mechanism of the Hunsdicker reaction. So, first of all, with the halogen, the Ag plus will be, one of the Br will be coming here with oxygen and the Ag will be leaving as AgBr. So we have this particular species here. This is a free radical mechanism. In the next case, what happens is one Br radical will be formed and on the top of oxygen will be having the another radical. So this is the unstable intermediate. This will be trying to become stable by removing of oxygen. So how carbon dioxide will be removed? So decarboxylation occurs. For decarboxylation, this radical moves here and this bond breaks as one radical going to this part and one upon R. So it will become C double bond O, which is CO2, which will be going, and remaining would be R radical and Br radical, which will be forming RBr or alkyl halide. Once again, you will be having the silver salt of carboxylic acid. The bromine, one of the bromine will be coming there. Then everything occurs according to free radical mechanism. First, the Br radical will be formed and O radical will be formed. RCOO radical will be there. Then decarboxylation occur, resulting in alkyl radical as well as halide radical. These together forms a bond and we get the alkyl halide. After that, let's take a look at what the other reactions are. So Ritter reaction is the acid-induced nucleophilic addition of nitrile to carbonium ion, and there will be hydrolysis to form amide. So starting compound is nitrile and we get an amide. Let's take a representative look reaction. So we'll be having a nitrile, and there will be acid will be there and hydrolysis also will be there. So amide will be formed. Now the next question is, next was about Darcens reaction. And in Darcens reaction, what happens is carbonyl compound with alpha halo ester will be forming an alpha beta epoxy ester in the presence of a base. Again, the representative reaction looks like this. So here we have a this carbonyl compound alpha halo ester will be there. This is the alpha halo ester, and this reacts with carbonyl compound and we get the alpha beta epoxy ester. Okay, that's it. These are the, please remember what these reactions are and the starting and the final product, because these kinds of reactions are usually asked in school set examination. Very less familiar ones also will be asked. So these should be there in your mind. Next question. The density of SO2 gas at 35 degrees Celsius and 715 torr is? So the answer is option D, 2.89 gram per liter. So first of all, you need to understand what are the units given. Your answer is in gram per liter and your pressure is given in torr and your value of temperature is given in degree Celsius. So you need to convert all these. Always be very sure of your units when you are doing mathematical problems. First of all, this is the ideal gas equation, which is PV equal to nRT. And we know that N, or the number of moles, can be written as given mass by molar mass. Further, we can rearrange this equation as P into molar mass, that is pressure into molar mass, divided by RT, which is the gas constant and temperature, as M by V, that is mass by volume, which is obviously our density. This is how you have to derive these kinds of equations. Now it is very simple. You have all the quantities with you. You know 715 is the value of the, we'll be having the value of pressure as 715 torr, but it should be converted into atm by dividing it by 760. And also here I have not written the value of temperature, so you know that it is 273. So our answer will be 308. So 308 Kelvin will be there. So what we have? We have 715 into 80. 80 is the molar mass of SO2. And also we have 760, which is used to convert the pressure into atm, and 0.082, which is R, and 308 Kelvin as the temperature, which will be the density. So on simplifying this, our answer would be equal to 2.89 gram per liter. Once again, PV is equal to nRT is the ideal gas equation. We know number of moles is given mass by molar mass. Then we will be rearranging this to get the density value, which is M by V. So PM by RT will be equal to density. And from that, pressure is given in torr. So we will be dividing it by 760 to get the value in atm. Then we will be writing temperature in Kelvin. It was 335 degrees Celsius. Now it becomes 308 degrees Celsius. Then we will be substituting the value, and we get the answer density as 2.89 gram per liter. Next question. A catalyst will increase the rate of a chemical reaction by, shifting the equilibrium to left or right, or increasing the activation or lowering the activation energy. So the main function of a catalyst is to lower the activation energy. So option B is our right answer. So what happens is, when we will be having lower activation energy, particles can react very easily. So the catalyst will not change during the reaction, but it just give a alternate pathway to the reaction. So something which initially required very high energy, once we use catalyst, it will be requiring only very low energy. So that is the purpose of a catalyst. So graphically, we can represent it like this. So what happens is, this is our reactant and this is our product. So to reach the product, initially it needed this much of energy. So this is the activation energy with no catalyst. I will write no catalyst as NC. So in NC, the activation energy is this high. But once we use catalyst, what happens is, we need only this much of energy to reach the product. So the with catalyst, the activation energy. So this is energy, and this will be the this y-axis will be energy, and this is the reaction coordinate. Reaction coordinate. So from reactant to product, and this energy represents the activation energy. Initially, without catalyst, it required this much of energy. Once we use catalyst, the energy will be decreasing a lot. That is the function of a catalyst. Next, this is from phase equilibria. So the number of components for KCl, NaCl, H2O, and KCl, NaBr, H2O systems are. So we have not discussed phase equilibria before. Here I'll be discussing the concept also. So what happens is, in phase equilibria, the components, the number of components C is actually defined as the smallest number of independent constituents by means of which composition of each phase can be expressed directly or in terms of a chemical equation. So simplified, we can write it, we can tell that the number of components, which is independent components, which can be used to express what the phase of a reaction is, that is known as components. So number of components can be written as number of chemical species minus number of independent equations. So C is equal to N minus He. So here what we need to find is C. And we have two different systems given here. For KCl, NaBr, H2O, we can write an independent equation like this. KCl plus NaBr gives NaCl plus KBr. So here we have total 5 chemical species. KCl, NaBr, H2O, NaCl and KBr. So we have C is equal to N minus E. And there is one independent equation, that is KCl plus NaBr giving NaCl plus KBr. So we have N equal to 5 and E equal to 1, and therefore our components would be 5 minus 1 equal to 4. And in the secondly, in the case of KCl, NaCl, H2O system, we don't have an independent equation, because we cannot write KCl plus NaCl giving KCl plus NaCl. It is not an equation, it is wrong. So since we do not have an independent equation, our E will be equal to 0, and we have only these three species present, these three chemical species, which is KCl, NaCl and H2O. And therefore, our answer of C will be equal to N minus 0, which is equal to N or equal to 3. So our answer would be option C, 3 and 4. What you need to find is whether you can express it by an equation, an independent equation. Then you need to subtract the number of independent equation from the number of chemical species. This is how you find the number of components when you have a system. Okay, I hope it is clear to you. C equal to N minus E. Write the equation, calculate the total number of chemical species, see whether you have an independent equation or not, just substitute in the given equation. Next question, this is from Chemistry in Daily Life. I have already done a video on this. Do watch it. It is very important. I have already told you, because this question is repeat. This type of questions are asked every year. So watch that video. I'll give the link in the description box. So here we have four different drugs, and we need to find whether which of these is the blood pressure lowering drug. So these are the chlorpheniramine is actually an antihistamine. And in the previous video, I have explained antihistamines are used to treat allergy conditions. Then methyl-dopa, which is for the high blood pressure. Ethambutol, it is for treating tuberculosis or TB. And it there are some many other medications for tuberculosis, like isoniazid, rifampicin, and so on. And metronidazole, it is for antibiotic and antiprotozoal medication. When you have, so these are the different drugs we have. And you need to understand option B is the correct answer here. But this can be asked. Any of the other options also can be asked. So please write this down and watch the video also. You can cover almost all the names through this, these practices itself. And that will be helping you in the examination. Further, next question is which one answer most accurately ranks the basicity of substituted anilines? So we have four different. So what happens here is there are different substitutions on aniline: cyano substitution, methoxy substitution, nitro substitution, and chloro substitution. You need to understand some points. First of all, we'll take a look at one by one. So what happens is aniline is less basic when we have an electron withdrawing substituent. So basic actually means you are ready to give electrons. So if you have an electron withdrawing substituent, those electrons will not be available to give to some other species, and therefore the basicity decreases. So if we are attaching an electron withdrawing substituent to the ring, the basicity decreases. Similarly, if you are attaching an electron donating group, the basicity increases. So more basic when electron donating group and less basic when electron withdrawing group. So that is the first point. Now, secondly, you need to understand that cyano group is strongly electron withdrawing. So what happens? The basicity will be very, very less in that case. Methoxy group is an electron donating group, and therefore it can donate the electrons and make it more basic. So methoxy group being an electron donating group increases the basicity by activating the ring. Nitro group is also a strongly deactivating group and pull the electrons from the amine group and make it less available for the donation and make it less basic. Halides. Halides is a peculiar type of group where the electronegativity makes them inductive electron withdrawing groups, but they will be electron donating through resonance. But here what happens? Here it is electron here the inductive withdrawing effects is more than the donating effect. So just making it slightly less basic, not very much like cyano or nitro, but it is making it slightly basic. So from these points, we have the answer as P methoxy aniline greater than, P chloro aniline greater than, 4 cyano aniline greater than, P nitro aniline. So methoxy aniline, because it's an electron donating group, chloro aniline, because though it is having both donating and withdrawing effects, slightly the withdrawing effect exceeds and therefore make it slightly less basic. Then cyano and nitro are both very, very strong electron withdrawing groups, which makes the aniline really, really less basic. So option D is our correct answer. Methoxy greater than, chloro greater than, nitro aniline. This order is not followed in any other option. So this would be our correct answer. Next question. Which of the following is an arachnoborane? We have four different boranes. So boranes, I have already done two videos, which is clearly explaining how to find the clozonido and arachnoborane. I'll be putting the link of those also in the description box. It will be very helpful for you. I have done lot of examples in those classes. You have to see those videos. You will be very familiar with this part. So this is, in a nutshell, this is the general formula for clozonido and arachno. If you have BnHn plus 2, then it is a clozoborane. BnHn plus 4, it is a nidoborane. And BnHn plus 6, it is an arachnoborane. Let's take a look at each of this. So here it is B4H10, which is B4H4 plus 6. Therefore, it is an arachnoborane. Option A is the correct answer. Now here what happens? B5H9 means it is B5H5 plus 4, which is a nidoborane. And here also it is again a nidoborane. But how to find these kinds of compounds? I'll tell you. So for each negative charge, you can add one hydrogen such that B6H6 2- minus can be written as B6H8. So whenever you have a negative charge on the boranes, you just add as many hydrogens as the charge in it. So if you have 2 minus charge, you should add 2 hydrogen and remove the charge. In that way, you can easily identify the borane. So this general formula should be memorized and also remember to add the number of hydrogens according to the charge of the anion. Next, these are about carboranes. Since already questions have come from the borane part, we can ask a few questions from the carborane part also. I expect the question from carborane part this year, so I am doing this question. Again, the answer here is C2B7H30. Let's take a look at how this happens. So, for B, the valency is 5. For carbon, it is 4. So, how can we write carbon? We can actually remove carbon from the carborane by replacing it by BH. Because since B is 5, on adding a hydrogen, it will become 4, the valency. Similarly, if you have a nitrogen, just replace it with by BH2. And if you have oxygen, just replace it by BH3. This is the way you have to identify the boranes if you have hetero atoms in that boranes, like carbon, nitrogen or oxygen. Now, C2B8H10 therefore can be written as, instead of C2, you can write it as BH2B8H10. So, BH2 will be adding up to BH2 will be adding up to this this thing as a whole. So, we'll be have 8 plus 2, which is just 11. Okay, sorry. 8 plus 2, this is 10. B10H12. So, this is a closo borane. Okay, so your first option is a closo borane. And second one, let's take a look. It is BnHn+4. In the third one, we have C2B7H30, which on substituting C with BH2, BH, we'll be having B9H15, which is the which will be BnHn+6 or arachno. That's why option C is our right answer. Again, last one is C2B4H8, which becomes B6H10, again a nidoborane. So first one is closo, second and fourth is nido, and C is arachno. So what you have to do when you have a hetero atom, just replace it with by boron and hydrogen, so that you will be you can easily find the type closo, nido and arachne. This is not just for carbon, nitrogen and oxygen. If any of any other elements of carbon, nitrogen or oxygen family comes, then it will be easier for you if you use this particular method. Next question is very simple. A crystal with A equal to B equal to C, but alpha equal to beta equal to gamma not equal to 90 degrees. So I have previously done a part on this crystal system and also how to memorize this portion. I'll be giving the link of that solid state portion also in the description box. Watch that. You can memorize all the crystal system in a short time using that particular method. So trigonal is the answer here. Memorize all the 7 crystal system along with their specification of edge length and angles. Now the 24th question is, the number of terminal bridging carbon is present in Fe2CO9 at low temperature respectively are. Let's take a look at its structure. So 6 and 3 is the answer. We have 6 terminal carbonyls and 3 bridging carbonyls in Fe2CO9. Let's take a look at its structure. So this is the structure of Fe2CO9. So we can see 2 Fe's are present, and in connecting these 2 Fe, we have 3 different carbonyls. So these are the 3 bridging carbonyls, and there is one metal-metal bond. That is also important. There is one MM bond. MM bond is there. And other 6 are existing as terminal carbonyls. So what is the specification of Fe2CO9? We are having 3 bridging carbonyls, 6 terminal carbonyls and 1 metal-metal bond. And also the hybridization of Fe in this is D2SP3. This is also very important. Okay, memorize this. So since already the question on Fe2CO9 is asked, another important question that can be asked from this part is the number of bridged and terminal carbonyls in COCO8 at low temperature. So at low and high temperature, it exists in 2 different states. So a bridge structure is obtained when it is in a solution state at very low temperature, and a non-bridge structure is in a solution at temperature above ambient. So in both this is a non-bridge state with above ambient. This is the structure which is having no carbonyl bridges but one metal-metal bond and 8
terminal carbons. But this is the structure we are looking for. That is in the low temperature. In the low temperature, it is having two carbonyl bridges, six terminal carbons, and one metal-metal bond. This is important. So, and in the bridge structure, that is in this structure, it is in the D2SP3 state, and in non-bridge structure, it is in DSP3 state. Cobalt is in DSP3 state in the first figure, and it is in D2SP3 state in the second figure. These are the two different ways in which CO8 exists, one at low temperature and one at temperature above ambience. Next, the time taken for 90% of a first order reaction to complete is approximately. So here in the options, the time is written as a terms of half-life. Let's take a look at it. So for a first order reaction, we already know that the rate constant K is given as 2.303 by T log A by A minus X. So A to 2.303 T log A by A minus X. And also we have K is equal to 0.693 divided by T half. So on substituting that in the equation, we will be getting this particular equation, that is T is equal to 2.303 into T half by 0.693 log 100 minus 100 minus 9, 100 by 100 minus 90 in this case, because 90% is completing, 90% reaction is complete. So from that, we'll be getting the answer as 3.3 T half. Okay. Now the next question, the fraction of the total current carried by the cation or anion is termed as, it is transport number. All the other options here are not really correct options. Only transport number is a valid thing, and this also known as Hitov's number. So the fraction of the total current carried by cation or anion is termed as the transport number. It is very important in electrochemistry, and please memorize this part. Now the 28th question, this is something you should keep in mind. Which of the following conformations of cyclohexane is chiral? So the solution of this is the twist board conformation, or option 2 is the correct answer. The twist board conformation of cyclohexane, it is optically active, or it is chiral, because it is not having any plane of symmetry. All the others have a plane of symmetry, and therefore they are not chiral. Only option 2 is correct, because only twist board conformation is optically active and is chiral. Okay. Now the next question is, chemically vitamin C is arachidonic acid, citric acid, lactic acid, or ascorbic acid. So chemically vitamin C is known as ascorbic acid. Previously I have in the previous videos I have already said how the names of common names of, or the alternate names of vitamin B family, what are the names I have discussed. So here we have covered vitamin C part also. In this way you will be familiar with all these portions. So vitamin C other chemically is known as ascorbic acid. Now, next question, which of the following is not a chelating agent? So the answer is pyridine. Why? Pyridine is a monodentate ligand. So how it can attach to the or coordinate with the metal only through one atom. So that is why it is known as a monodentate ligand. But whereas all the others can form, act as chelating agents, because ethylene diamine or EN, it is having this structure. So you can see from this itself, it can attach, if there is a metal, it can attach like this and it can form a chelation. Similarly, in oxalate iron also, it can attach through both these oxygens. And in case of ethylene diamine tetraacetate, it is a hexadentate ligand. It has three each, 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3. It has six ways to attach, and therefore all the other three than pyridine is chelating, can act as chelating agents. So we have discussed very important 30 questions of CUSET exam today. I hope this is becoming very easy for you once you are doing all this yourself also. I'll be attaching the links of previous CUSET exam questions discussion also here towards the end. I think it will be here somewhere on the screen now. And also, please do continue watch the Super Preparatory series. We'll be doing next two series on other exams like JNU, Pondicherry University, as well as BHU, etc. in the coming days. All those will be important for all examination. So I strongly suggest you to watch all the Super Preparation series part, because it will cover your syllabus as much as possible by the end of the series. And thank you so much for watching. Keep preparing. Though the examinations are delayed due to the pandemic situation, it will be definitely taking place in the coming days. And as much time you can, you just spend for this preparation so that your rank will be really high in the examination. Thank you so much. Have a good day, everyone.